some of the most important things that we've identified over the last decade or so reinforce and confirm what we suspected earlier, that the type of fat in the diet is extremely important, trans fat being the worst. And the evidence has really gotten stronger that unsaturated fats have beneficial effects, and both polyunsaturated fat and monounsaturated fat in the diet. Also, the importance of carbohydrate quality has become almost as equal as the importance of quality of fat in the diet. And we see the large amounts of refined starch and sugar in the diet having many adverse metabolic effects, and now we see clear relationships with diabetes risk as well as with weight gain as well. That mainly means that it's important to minimize the amount of refined starch and sugar and instead be eating whole grains and legumes as primary sources of carbohydrate in the diet. It makes a really big difference. We're also finding that diet is having important effects on cognitive function as well, and that's a new area of research. Partly we can look at it because our populations that we study are getting older and cognitive function is declining in some people. Yes, Alzheimer's disease is sort of the end state, but even before that, people start to forget things and have cognitive dysfunction affecting their quality of life. And it looks like diet can make a big difference there as well. We still have a lot to learn in that area, but it's a very exciting time because in some ways the brain is the last frontier. And in human biology, we know how the heart works, the kidney works, the liver works, the brain, we still don't really know how it works very well. Kuckermann's been raised as an issue. We don't have enough consumption of that in the United States that we've really been able to study it. So I think it's not a proven approach, but there's potential. It needs to be looked at more. We do see that in general, the Mediterranean diet pattern is strongly beneficial for preventing decline in cognitive function, and we're digging down more deeply to find out what it is about the Mediterranean diet pattern that's important, and very interesting clues are emerging. Well, one of the big problems is that people are getting a huge amount of confusing, conflicting information, and that leaves them sometimes to believe that, oh, we don't know what to do, we don't know anything, and that's really not true. Yeah, right, that people give up. And some of this is purposeful confusion because Coca-Cola has been funding academics to create confusion, and journalists find it, it sells papers and magazines to have sensationalist findings that are not really supported scientifically. So there's strong, powerful elements out there that are creating confusion. Social media, bloggers, people who really don't have any scientific background are pumping out their latest theory, and there's just too much information. But the reality is, and it's also fair to say that scientists disagree sometimes, and but that disagreement is often magnified by the press. That I think the point of the meeting yesterday was that even though there's still some issues that are debated, in the big picture, we know that a diet that's built on fruits and vegetables and whole grains and nuts and seeds as primary sources of energy and food will be a very healthy diet. And it's also pretty quite clear, modest amounts of some fish and some poultry. If you don't want to be a vegan, you can have those and still also have a very healthy diet. So those basic elements, there's strong agreement on, but that's not the message that the public is getting. There's a very common core that I think has very strong scientific support, and we can convey to the public, and with great confidence, if that's the way they eat, they will be much more likely to have a longer and healthier life. Interestingly, the prototypic traditional diet is a Mediterranean diet that fits that pattern, but we now understand it well enough so that we can put together the elements in other diet, using other foods, other dietary patterns, other flavors that will also be putting the same pieces together create a very healthy diet. Well, if we really depended on randomized double-blind trials to believe something, we'd be extremely ignorant, because most questions can't be answered by randomized double-blind trials. What is the weather going to be like tomorrow? Actually, we can predict that pretty well, but it's not based on a randomized double-blind trial. Randomized double-blind trials were really developed for testing new drugs primarily, and they worked very well there. But for most other questions, it's really not possible to do randomized double-blind trials. And even if you do them, the randomized trials can often give wrong answers and misleading answers. Take something like smoking, which everyone would agree is the most powerful adverse thing we can do in terms of undermining our health. But there have been several randomized trials done looking at smoking, and they basically showed no effect on mortality. And so why is that? Well, part of the problem is that people who stopped smoking started again, and also the trials didn't really go long enough. We know that you need to smoke about 30 years before lung cancer rates actually start to go up. And
it's a very long study.
Yes, you can't really conduct dietary trials for that long. So if you want to look at diet and cancer, diet and a lot of other conditions, not only are randomized trials hard to do, they can be very misleading for reasons of people not adhering to the diet, not studying patients long enough. So I think we do have very strong evidence with using a combination of different kinds of studies. For example, looking at long-term observational studies on diet and health outcomes, and then that combined with carefully controlled feeding studies done for a few weeks looking at changes in intermediate biomarkers like blood lipids, blood pressure. And when we have all those pieces pointing in the same direction, we can be quite confident. Definitely olive oil is going to be superior to butter, and we've got all different kinds of studies which point in that direction. We need more studies of coconut fat, but from everything we've seen, it's not going to be an optimal fat. It is very saturated, even though the type of saturated fatty acids is a little different, it still has adverse effects on blood cholesterol fractions. I think actually all the liquid vegetable oils are healthy. We need both omega-6 and omega-3 fatty acids. There was never any real evidence that omega-6 was bad for us, but there's a myth that's gotten a lot of attention that omega-6 are bad for us, and that's very wrong. That we see the best health in people who have both higher omega-6 and higher omega-3. Nuts are, I think we need to say that nuts have been studied intensively because we know that the types of fats are healthy, but of course they contain a lot more. There's lots of fiber and micronutrients as well, and many long-term studies showing that people who eat nuts have lower risk of heart disease and diabetes. So there's a huge amount of evidence around nuts. For avocados, the type of fat there is unsaturated fat and almost for sure healthy fat. We don't have long-term studies of people eating large amounts of avocados, though. So I think we have to say...
Is that
the
Mexicans?
Right, yes. They're actually, my colleagues in Mexico have launched a study, and they should be able to answer that. Clearly the worst source of fat would be trans fat from partially hydrogenated vegetable oil. These days, many of the margarines, in fact, most of the margarines have eliminated trans fat, and so most of them are pretty healthy. Now, the older margarines were clearly a huge problem, and some of the partially hydrogenated cooking fats too. Animal fats, fat from dairy sources, butter, and from tallow, from red meat in general, lard are unhealthy fats also. Having them in small amounts now and then is not a problem. If you really like the flavor of butter in a dish, that's not a problem. But having them as a main everyday fat is not the healthiest type of fat. Now, nutrition is interesting that some people want to go to extremes, and that we do know that too many grains is not a good thing. In a lot of populations of the world are getting 70-80% of their calories from grains, and that's really an imbalanced diet. Well, even if it's even in the form of whole grains would be too much. It doesn't provide a good balance. But definitely white flour, when the grains are, the biggest problem with grains is processing them and turning them into white flour. That can take a basically healthy product and turn it into quite an unhealthy product. Paleo diets have gotten a lot of attention, partly because there's an element of truth to them compared to the paleo diets basically had low amounts of grains in them, and of course really no added sugar to them, and compared to what we're eating today, that actually has an important benefit, reducing the amounts of refined starch and sugar. Yeah, you're absolutely right. If the paleo diet as it's practiced today, which is a lot of animal products, sausage and cheese and red meat and bacon, that clearly is a very unhealthy diet. However, there can be a version of a paleo diet that's more toward a plant-based paleo diet that can be quite healthy, there'd be no refined starch and sugar and small amounts of grains, but then a lot of fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds. That would be a very healthy paleo diet. And even our colleagues who have sort of invented the paleo diet acknowledge that and agree that that would be a healthy version of a paleo diet. And of course, add some fish in there too, and that's sort of how I eat. Yeah, well, cow's milk is one of the most complex, interesting aspects of nutrition because milk, by definition, is sort of a complete food. It's amazing that a baby can have nothing but its mother's milk and grow in months and develop. It's astonishing that milk is so complete. Now, that's human milk, of course, and cow's milk has a different composition, but milk is really meant to promote rapid growth. And that's really important early in life, but we're not supposed to be revving up our metabolic machinery to the highest speed all of our life. There's likely adverse effects of that. And also, milk does come along with a lot of unhealthy fats. So we know that it's not going to be the optimal food in large amounts for adults and throughout life. I think, small amounts of dairy, it looks like there are some special benefits of yogurt, possibly because of the effect on the microbiome. A dairy-based diet overall is not going to be a healthy diet. Interesting, Finland was a dairy-based diet. They had the highest heart disease rates in the world, and they worked hard to reduce their consumption of dairy. Butter it was actually about 18% of calories, and they reduced that to about 3% of calories, a huge change, and instead mostly replaced that with rapeseed oil, which is a healthy fat. And heart disease rates came down 85%. Of course, they were doing some other things too, promoting activity and lower salt intake and fruits and berries, but virtually for sure the biggest change was reducing the role of dairy in their diet. Well, the answer may be somewhat a little bit in between. I think in general, keeping dairy, dairy is not an essential part of diet. Most of the world, as adults, does not consume dairy, or until very recently did not consume dairy, and they had low fracture rates. And the main justification used for high dairy consumption is prevention of fractures, and that doesn't seem to be that milk is important that way. And in fact, what we're seeing is that high dairy consumption during adolescence is related to higher risk of fractures later in life. It's probably because it makes our bones grow too long and slender, and those are easier to break. This idea that we have to drink milk for healthy bones has never been supported by any data. In fact, we've known for over 50 years that it's actually the countries that drink the most milk actually have by far the highest rates of fractures later in life. And now I think we're starting to understand part of the reason for this paradox, and part of it is that it does make our, right, the growth factors that make our bones actually too long and more easy to break. So on the other hand, having a modest amount of cheese and some yogurt in modest amounts, that's okay. It's not necessary, but it's okay.
But if you want to say a few sentences.
Sure, I think it's pretty easy to describe what would basically be a healthy diet, which is healthy fats, healthy forms of carbohydrate, healthy sources of protein, mostly meaning low amounts of red meat in the diet, with nuts, legumes, and some poultry and fish if you like those for other sources of protein, and add plenty of fruits and vegetables, and you've got a pretty healthy diet.
That's it. Thank you very much.
Sure.